Section 1 of Kentucky's Famous Feuds and Tragedies by Charles G. Melin. Kentucky's Famous Feuds and Tragedies by Charles G. Mutzenberg. Section 1. Preface and Introduction. Preface. The feudal wars of Kentucky have, in the past, found considerable publicity through newspapers. Unfortunately, many newspaper reporters dealing with this subject were either deprived of an opportunity to make a thorough investigation of the facts, or permitted their imagination to supply what they had failed to obtain. At any rate, the result was distortion of the truth and exaggeration. Exaggeration is not needed to make Kentucky's feudal wars of thrilling, intensely gripping interest to every reader. More than a score of years were spent in the collection of this material, involving tedious and painstaking investigations. The greatest difficulty was experienced in separating truth from falsehood. Often the most vital facts could be obtained solely from the actors in the bloody dramas. The feudists and their relatives proved, quite naturally, partial or prejudiced, and at all times were reluctant to admit any fact detrimental to their side or favorable to their enemies. I believe, however, that I have succeeded, with the aid of court records, legislative investigations, and official military reports, in my task of producing a strictly authentic history of Kentucky's famous feuds and their attending tragedies. I trust that the publication of this volume will serve its designed purpose, to make crime odious, to illustrate the havoc that may be wrought anywhere through the lax, inefficient, or corrupt administration of justice, to arouse the people, not of Kentucky only, but of the country at large, to the necessity of dealing sternly with crime and faithless officers. Charles D. Mutzenberg, Harlan, Kentucky, September 1916. Introduction. A brief review of the history of Kentuckians may assist the reader to understand why they, a kind, hospitable people to the stranger, have so long borne the reputation of ready fighters who often kill upon the slightest provocation, and deserve that reputation in a large measure. It is bread in the bone for a Kentuckian to quickly resent an insult or redress an injury. Long before the advent of the white man, Kentucky, then Fincastle County, Virginia, had been the vast hunting grounds of the Cherokees, Creeks, Chickasaws, and Catawbas of the South, and of the more hostile tribes of Shawnees, Delawares, and Wyandots of the North. These tribes, when chance brought them together on their annual hunts, engaged in conflicts so instant, so fierce and pitiless, that the territory became known as the Dark and Bloody Ground. It was indeed a hunter's paradise. Dense forests covered the mountains. Canebrakes fringed the banks of numerous beautiful streams, while to the west lay immense undulating plains. Forest, canebrake, and plain were literally alive with bear, deer, and the buffalo. The woods teemed with innumerable squirrels, pheasants, wild turkeys, and quail. The fame of this hunting ground had attracted bold and adventurous hunters long before Daniel Boone looked upon one of the most beautiful regions in the world from the crest of Cumberland Mountain. These hunters, upon their return home, gave glowing accounts of the richness and fertility of the new country, and excited powerfully the curiosity and imagination of the frontier backwoodsmen east of the Alleghenies and of North Carolina. To the hardy adventurers, the lonely wilderness, with its many dangers, presented attractions not to be found in the confinement and enfeebling inactivities of the towns and little settlements. Daniel Boone visited the new territory. He found that the descriptions he had received of it were by no means exaggerations, and decided to remove thither with his family. After some delay, amid many difficulties, the first white settlement, Harrodstown, or Harrodsburg, was established. Within a few years other stations sprang into existence, and population increased with amazing rapidity. Immigrants crossing the Cumberland Mountain settled in the eastern and central parts of Kentucky, while those traveling down the Ohio and Mississippi rivers generally located in the northern, western, and southern portions of the state. This invasion by the white man was not accomplished, however, without long-continued bloody struggles with the savages. To maintain the slender foothold Boone and his companions had gained required great courage and tenacity of purpose. The man who shivered at the winter's blast, or trembled at every noise, the origin of which he did not understand, was not known among those hardy settlers with nerves of iron and sinews of steel, who were accustomed from earliest childhood to absolute self-dependence, and inured to exposure and dangers of every sort. Man, in this connection, must include the pioneer woman who by their heroism illustrated their utter contempt of danger and an insensibility to terrors which would palsy the nerves of men reared in the peaceful security of densely populated communities. Even children of tender years exhibited a courage and self-composure under trying circumstances that at this day seem unbelievable. The life of the Kentucky pioneer and backwoodsman was one of long and bitter struggle. Hunting, clearing the forest, plowing and fighting were his daily occupations. Every station had its conflicts with the savages who fought with relentless desperation when they found themselves gradually but surely driven from their beloved hunting grounds. These armed hunters and farmers were their own soldiers. They built their own forts. They did their fighting under commanders they had themselves chosen. They fought the foe in his own style, adopted his mode of warfare, and proved generally more successful than bodies of troops who battled under time-honored military tactics. The Indian understood the advantage of cover, and the white man copied his methods. Thus, most of the Indian fights became nothing more nor less than ambuscades in which the side displaying the most skill in placing them won the victory. Boone, Kenton, Brady, Wetzel, all that galaxy of pioneers and Indian fighters of the early West fought the enemy from ambush. There were few courts, and the justices presiding over them knew but little law. If the law proved too slow, or courts were too far away, the settlers tried criminals and inflicted the punishment. The backwoodsman was prompt to avenge a wrong. He was grim, stern, strong, easily swayed by stormy passions, and always a lover of freedom to the core. He had suffered horrible injuries from the Indians, and learned to retaliate in kind. He became cruel and relentless toward an enemy, but was loyal to the death to his friends and country. He was upright and honest. These pioneers were indeed cast in the heroic mold. Many of them fell in the struggle, but there was no time for sentiment and wailing. Over the prostrate bodies of the fallen civilization marched triumphantly westward, and gave to America one of the most attractive regions, to the nation heroic soldiers, brilliant lawyers, men of science and of art, and a womanhood whose beauty and accomplishments are a byword everywhere. With the close of Indian hostilities came rapid development of the more easily accessible portions of the state. Intercourse with the East and North obliterated old habits and customs and primitive notions. The fertility of the soil created wealth, and with it came comfort. With increasing prosperity came that high intellectual development so essential to a sound, moral public sentiment, respect for the law, and love of peace and order, the foundation stones of a happy social structure. Schools and churches demonstrated their all-powerful influence by the refinement and social purity of the inhabitants. The code duello, which had formerly been restored to almost universally in settling personal differences, was made a crime by law and completely disappeared. In the mountains, however, development was slow. That section remained isolated and practically cut off from intercourse with the more populous and advanced portions of Kentucky and surrounding states. Only in recent years have railroads begun to spread their iron network through the mountains, tapping the almost inexhaustible coal veins, mineral deposits of various kinds, wonderful forests of timber, until now that section has become the richest in the state. Education and refinement distinguished the bluegrass Kentuckian at an early date. He had long enjoyed the advantages of modern civilization, while his mountaineer brother yet lived in the primitive fashion of his forebears, and still remained a backwoodsman. He suffered the same privations, and possessed the traits of character of the early pioneers of the bluegrass. For long years the mountain section remained a wilderness, with here and there a small settlement. The inhabitants lived the lives of frontiersmen and were generally poor. While many of them owned large tracts of land, its productiveness scarcely repaid the labor spent in cultivation. The great majority of these people were honest, upright, and hard-working. But the wilderness, the frontier, unfortunately attracts the vicious, the violent, the criminal, the shiftless, the outcast of better communities. Such characters have a pernicious influence upon those with whom they come in contact, especially upon the young and thoughtless fellows with a taste for viciousness. The mountains of the surrounding states of Virginia, West Virginia, and Tennessee offered admirable asylum to fugitives from justice of those states. As like seeks like, individuals and families of that stripe settled near each other, intermarried, and thus formed a dangerous element in an otherwise good population. Life in the wilderness, the frontier, is apt to bring out the true nature of the man, and his qualities, good or bad, are accentuated. The history of every frontier of this country is the same. The man who leaves the restraining influence of civilization behind him becomes either man or devil. If there is dog hair in a man, the wilderness, the frontier, will sprout it. When the wicked element in a community had once gained a foothold, it organized against possible interference. Once organization was complete, all attempts to enforce law and order were promptly stifled through terrorization, which intimidated courts and overawed the officers of the law. Under such circumstances, the good element has but one alternative, to lie supinely on its back and ask to be killed, or to organize and strike back at the enemy, to destroy the vicious with powder and shot, in open fight, if possible, from ambush, if necessary, as their sires fought in the days of the Indian. Herein lies the secret of the long-continued, bloody internecine strifes which have made the dark and bloody ground of the Indian days more dark and more bloody. Herein we find the ready and clear explanation of the fact that many men of unquestioned integrity and honor were thrown into the vortex of bloody strife from necessity to fight for preservation of themselves, their families, their firesides. Immigration into these remote mountain regions was almost nil, and intermarriage between the settlers became the rule. In this wise, the population of any county comprised but very few distinct families. Everybody was kin to everybody else, and therein we find the key to the difficulties encountered by courts in dealing with crime. The murderer, if a member of a prominent family, was certain to have kinsmen among the officers. We may as well use the present tense in speaking of this, for the same conditions exist today, though less pronounced. His family, man, woman, and child, stand by him, aid his escape or his defense in the courthouse. If the criminal, conscious of the supporting influence surrounding him, disdains flight and boldly faces trial, the next move is to secure a jury which will acquit him. It often happens that those interested in the prosecution secretly come to an agreement with the accused and his friends to cease prosecution, provided he and his, in their turn, would do the same to them in cases of their own. It is merely a case of, you scratch my back and I'll scratch yours. Citizens who love peace are loath to antagonize an outlaw clan so long as they or theirs are not directly concerned. They have no desire to assist officers in doing their duty, should these wish to do it. To indict men for crime is often a risky thing. The criminal who has succeeded in defeating justice grows more bold, continues to pursue his career with an enhanced contempt of the law, until, at last, the cup runs over, and men, good and true, rise above self, and for country's and humanity's sake, take upon themselves the task of restoring peace and order, and summarily cut short the life cycle of the outlaw. How far such organized bands of murderers have succeeded in overawing the constituted authorities is illustrated by instances recorded in this volume, where the law, the government itself, actually compromised with the outlaws, promised, yea, granted them immunity from past crimes, only exacting a pledge of better behavior in the future. If a man had committed but one little murder, he was in some danger of a short term in the penitentiary. If he understood his business, instead of stopping at one assassination, he simply continued his murder mill in operation, and the authorities would send special ministers and envoys to treat with him as a power entitled to respect. Exaggeration? No. Officers of the law have actually aided in assassinations, or stood idly by while murders were committed in their presence. Investigation has proven that in every feud-ridden section, the entire legal machinery was rotten to the core, perverted to the end and purpose of protecting particular men and of punishing their enemies. Is it any wonder, then, that in such times and under such conditions, preaching respect for law is breath wasted? Sifting the matter down, we find that the chief contributing causes of these feudal troubles, wherever they have occurred, or may again occur, are due directly to inefficient, corrupt, and depraved official, to a want of a healthy moral public sentiment, through lack of proper education and religious training, to the fact that the law-abiding element of feud-ridden counties has so long been domineered over by the criminal class and their parasites and supporters in secret, that they are incapable of rendering any valuable assistance in maintaining the law, save in few exceptions, and these few so much in the minority that a reformation is not to be hoped for, if left to their own resources. That, during all the social chaos attending feudal wars, the promiscuous, unrestrained, and illegal sale of whiskey added fury, fire, and venom to the minds and hearts of murderers. It dragged into the terrible vortex of bloody crime many not directly connected with the feud, but who took advantage of the disturbed social conditions, the state of anarchy, to satisfy their own vicious propensities without fear of interruption and punishment. The clannishness of the mountaineer has been the subject of much comment. The student of sociology must, therefore, be interested in learning that, in a great measure, the people of the Kentucky mountains descended from the same stock that formed the noted Scottish clans of old. One need only run over the names of the principal mountain families to recognize their Scot origin. The Scots love the highlands, and to the highlands of Kentucky many of them drifted. Scotland had her feuds. Those of the Kentucky mountains are nothing more nor less than transplanted Scottish feuds, their continuation having been made possible by the reasons heretofore given. We believe it germane to the matter under discussion to add that not only feuds, but mobs and the like, are, and ever have been, the direct outgrowth of a lack of confidence of the people in their courts. The shameful night rider outrages in the western part of Kentucky a few years ago, in a section which had boasted of a civilization superior by far to that of the mountaineers, where schools and churches are to be met with at every corner, were the outcome, so it is claimed, of the failure of the law to deal sternly with the lawless tobacco trust, the original wrongdoer in the noted tobacco war. If this were true, if this justified the destruction by incendiaries of millions of dollars' worth of property, brutal whippings, the indiscriminate slaughter of entire families without regard to age or sex, the butchery of little children, for aiding the tobacco trust, no doubt, then indeed is the mountaineer feudist also innocent of wrongdoing. More so, for he, at least, never made war upon suckling infants, nor have women suffered harm, except in one or two instances. Nor is the cultured bluegrass citizen free to censure him when he calls to mind the outrages of the toll-gate raids, or takes into account the numerous lynching bees, proceedings from which the mountains have always been practically free. In view of all this, we cannot go far from wrong when we say that the law's delay, the failure to punish promptly, impartially, and severely its infractions, must shoulder the responsibility of all social disturbances, and this is true in New York, in the West, as well as in Kentucky. End of section 1. Section 2 of Kentucky's Famous Feuds and Tragedies by Charles G. Mutzenberg. Kentucky's Famous Feuds and Tragedies by Charles G. Mutzenberg. Section 2. The Great Hatfield-McCoy Feud, Part 1. Perhaps no section in the whole United States has ever been the scene of more crime and long-continued defiance of the law than that contiguous to the Tug Fork, one of the tributaries of the Big Sandy River, and which forms the boundary line between West Virginia and Kentucky, separating Logan County, West Virginia, from Pike County, Kentucky. Many feuds have been fought there, but none equaled in ferocity the bloody Hatfield-McCoy War, during which crimes of the most revolting nature were perpetrated. Indeed, it will be difficult for the reader to believe that the devilish deeds related in this chapter are actually true, and did occur in the midst of a civilized country, peopled with Christian men and women, and governed by wholesome laws. Yes, citizens of a common country fought a struggle to the bitter death without hindrance, if not with the actual connivance of those entrusted with the enforcement of law and the maintenance of order, who looked idly upon bloodshed. The flag of anarchy, once unfurled, fluttered unmolested for years. Had the feud broken out suddenly and been quickly suppressed, we should abstain from strictures upon high officials entrusted with the administration and execution of the law. But this American vendetta covered a long period, abating somewhat at times, only to break out anew with increased ferocity. Utter disregard for human life, ruthless, savage cruelty, distinguish this feud from all others and easily give it the front rank. To add to the horror of it all came the bitter controversy between the governors of West Virginia and Kentucky, nearly precipitating civil war between the two states, and effectively paralyzing all attempts at concerted action looking toward the capture, trial, and punishment of the outlaws, at least for a long time. That the feud is ended now is due largely to the fact that the material upon which it had been feeding for so many years became exhausted through the pistol, rifle, or the knife. But few died of disease, only one was hanged, perhaps the least guilty of them all, for he was a moral degenerate of such little intelligence that under other circumstances he might have escaped the gallows on the ground of mental irresponsibility. The leading spirits of the war were never punished, but rounded out their lives at home unmolested. The region along the Tug Fork is mountainous, and has not until recently come in touch with the outside world. Its inhabitants for many years knew nothing of schools or churches. Ignorance prevailed to a truly astonishing degree. Courts exercised no authority. Their decrees were laughed at and ridiculed. If a man thought himself aggrieved, he sought redress as best suited him. The natives tried cases in their own minds and acted as executioners, using the rifle or the knife. When trials, in rare instances, were resorted to, they more than often fanned the flame of hatred than smothered it. The contending factions in this internecine strife lived on opposite sides of the Tug Fork, a narrow stream. Randall McCoy, the leader or head of the McCoy faction, resided on the Blackberry branch of Pond Creek in Pine County, Kentucky. Near him, but on the opposite side of Tug Fork, in West Virginia, lived Anderson Hatfield, who had adopted for himself the nom de guerre of Bad Ants, or Devil Ants, the controlling spirit of the Hatfield clan. Both families were large, extensively related throughout the two counties, and composing the greater portion of their population. The McCoys and Hatfields frequently intermarried, and thus it happens that we find McCoys arrayed on the side of the Hatfields, and Hatfields friendly to the Randall McCoy faction. While the feud proper did not break out until 1882, it is necessary to go back further. For the enmity between the Hatfields and McCoys dates back to the Civil War, during which the former maintained an organized company of raiders, ostensibly for the purpose of protecting property against invading marauders of either army. The McCoys supported a similar force on the Kentucky side. These bands frequently encroached upon and entered each other's territory, resulting in clashes and bad blood, though both factions adhered to the same political party. After the war, the older heads tried to maintain a show of friendship in their intercourse, but the younger generations allowed their passions a free hand. Difficulties grew in frequency. Still, no lives were lost. A few razor-backed, long-legged, sharp-nosed porkers are the indispensable adjunct of well-regulated mountaineer families. In those days the farmer marked his hogs and turned them loose in the woods. they soon fattened on the abundant mast and were, late in the fall, driven home to be killed. If one of those marked hogs happened to turn up in the possession of another, woe unto him. Vengeance was visited upon him swiftly, though not as severe as in the case of rustlers in the West. A circuit judge of Kentucky once remarked, very appropriately, that a hog seemed of more value in his district than a human life. There was truth in this bit of sarcasm. More men have been acquitted of murder in Kentucky than of hog-stealing. It seems ridiculous that a few of the unseemly brutes should have become the innocent promoters of a feud, but it is true. Innocent or not, the facts are against them. Sometime during the 70s, one Floyd Hatfield, afterwards known as Hog Floyd, drove a number of hogs from the forests and confined them in a pen at Stringtown. A few days later, Randolph McCoy of Kentucky passed the pen in question, and upon examination of the animals, claimed them as his property and demanded their delivery to him, which Hog Floyd refused to do. McCoy brought an action for their recovery. The trial was held at Raccoon Hollow, a little village some miles down the valley. Deacon Hatfield, Floyd's relative, presided. The McCoys and Hatfields attended the trial in force. Every man was armed. During the short trial, many things occurred that convinced those acquainted with the characters of the men composing the factions that bloody hostilities must result. Randolph McCoy made an impassioned speech to the jury, openly charging several Hatfield witnesses with perjury. Among those so accused was one Staten, who, incensed by the charge, attempted to strike his traducer, but was prevented by Randolph McCoy's son. McCoy lost his case. The Hatfields exulted, jeered, and sneered. The McCoys returned home grumbling and threatening. Fists and rocks now gave place to the rifle, and repeated long-range shooting matches occurred between the factions. When meeting in the forests, they treed and fought for hours with their old-fashioned muzzle-loaders and cap and ball pistols without any appreciable result. In 1880 occurred the first battle in which blood was drawn. It happened about a mile below the Hatfield Tunnel between Bill Staten, Paris, and Sam McCoy. They had met by accident. Staten rightly guessed that the boys would show him no mercy after the many injuries and insults they had received at his hands. Instantly he leaped behind a bush, broke off the top of it, rested his gun in the fork of two limbs, took careful aim, and fired. Paris McCoy fell heavily to the ground. Although severely wounded in the hip, he managed to regain his feet and shot Staten in the breast. The two then came together in a fierce hand-to-hand combat. Having thrown down their empty and useless rifles, they fought with their hands and teeth, ferocious as wild animals. Paris's cheek was frightfully bitten and lacerated. Weakened from loss of blood and suffering excruciating pain from his wounds, he was about to succumb to the superior strength of his powerful adversary when Sam McCoy, armed with a pistol, came to his rescue. He had been afraid to fire while the men were locked in their deadly embrace. Now came the opportunity, and he sent a ball crashing through the brain of Staten, who fell back and instantly expired. The body was found some days later. Suspicion at once pointed to the two McCoy brothers. Paris promptly surrendered himself to the authorities and was given an examining trial before Magistrate Valentine, or Val, Hatfield, who released him from custody. Sam McCoy fled to the hills, but after eluding the officers for a month or more, was captured by Elias Hatfield, indicted by the grand jury of his county, tried, and acquitted. In the summer of 1882, it happened that a relative and friend of both factions ran for office in Pike County. The Klan met on Election Day, August 7th, to work for their man. It was the custom then, as well as now, although the law has placed serious restrictions upon the practice, to supply voters with copious quantities of whiskey. A candidate who failed to do his duty in this respect was certain to lose many votes, if not the chance of election. On the occasion in question, moonshine liquor was plentiful. Both the Hatfields and McCoys and their adherents imbibed freely, and during the day grew boisterous and belligerent. The immediate occasion for beginning a fight was furnished when Tolbert McCoy approached Elias Hatfield, commonly known as Bad Lias, and demanded payment of an old debt. A quarrel ensued, and the fight was on. Bad Lias got the worst of it. The fight had attracted the attention of the friends and kindred of both men. Officers attempted to separate them without avail. Then Big Ellison Hatfield took a hand. Enraged and on fire with copious drinks of whiskey, he challenged the victorious Tolbert McCoy to fight a man of his size. Hatfield was a powerful man. Straight as an arrow, he stood 6 feet 6 in his stocking feet and weighed considerably over 200 pounds. The fight now went against McCoy from the start. He resorted to his knife and, during the struggle, stabbed Hatfield repeatedly and with frightful effect. Again and again he plunged the cold steel into the body of his adversary. Though horribly slashed and losing much blood, Hatfield yet retained strength. With a final effort he threw McCoy upon the ground, sat upon him, seized a large jagged stone, raised it on high to strike the fatal blow, when Famer McCoy, who had been patiently waiting for the opportunity, fatally shot Hatfield with a pistol. It was also charged by the Hatfields that Randolph McCoy, Jr., a youth of 15, had stabbed Hatfield once or twice. As soon as Famer McCoy saw the effect of his shot, he dropped the weapon and sought safety in flight. He was pursued by Constable Floyd Hatfield and captured. Tolbert and young Randolph were also immediately arrested. The wounded Hatfield was removed to the house of one of his kinsmen. The prisoners remained on the election ground under heavy guard for some 2 hours. Then they were taken to the house of Johns Hatfield for the night. Tolbert Hatfield and Joseph Hatfield, two justices of the peace of Pike County, Kentucky, Matthew, Floyd, and other Hatfields had charge of the prisoners. The father of the three, old Randolph McCoy, remained with them through the night. End of section 2. Section 3 of Kentucky's Famous Feuds and Tragedies by Charles G. Mutzenberg. Kentucky's Famous Feuds and Tragedies by Charles G. Mutzenberg. Section 3. The Great Hatfield-McCoy Feud, Part 2. Early on the following morning, the officers proceeded with their charges on the road to Pikeville, the county seat. Scarcely had they traveled half a mile when they were overtaken by Val Hatfield, the West Virginia Justice of the Peace, and Bad Lias Hatfield, brothers of the wounded Ellison. They demanded of the officers that they return with their prisoners into the magisterial district in which the fight had occurred to await the result of Ellison Hatfield's wounds. The officers complied with the demand. Randolph McCoy, Sr. remonstrated, but was laughed at for his pains. He then started alone to Pikeville for the purpose of consulting with the authorities there. That was the last time he saw his three sons alive. After being turned back by Val and Bad Lias Hatfield, the prisoners were taken down the creek. At an old house there was a corn sled. Val directed the three brothers placed in it, and in that manner they were conveyed to Jerry Hatfield's house. Here Charles Carpenter, who, together with Devil Anse and Cap Hatfield, Alex Messer, the three Mayhorn brothers, and a number of other outlaws, had joined Val Hatfield and the other officers at the old house, procured ropes, and securely trussed and bound the prisoners. In this condition they remained until they were murdered. At noon the crowd stopped at the Reverend Anderson Hatfield's for dinner. After the meal was over, Devil Ant stepped into the yard and there cried out, "All who are friends of Hatfield, fall into line." Most of those present did so from inclination or through fear. From there the prisoners were taken to the river and across into West Virginia to an old, dilapidated schoolhouse. Here they lay, tied upon the filthy floor. Heavily armed guards at all times stood sentinel over the doomed brothers. Cap and Johns Hatfield, Devil Anse and his two brothers, Elias and Val Hatfield, Charles Carpenter, Joseph Murphy, Doc Mayhorn, Pliant Mayhorn, Selkirk McCoy and his two sons, Albert and L.D., Lark and Anderson Varney, Dan Witt, Sam Mayhorn, Alex Messer, John Witt, Elias Mounts, and many others remained at or about the schoolhouse, awaiting news from the bedside of Ellison Hatfield. Along toward night arrived the mother of the unfortunate prisoners, and the wife of Tolbert McCoy, to plead with the jailers for the lives of the sons and husband. The pleadings of the grief-stricken women fell upon deaf ears. They had no other effect upon these hearts of stone than rough admonitions from Val Hatfield and others to shut up, stop that damn noise, we won't have no more of it. Night had fallen. The women were told to leave and thrust from the house into the inky darkness. It had been raining hard and the creeks were swollen. Wading streams, drenched to the skin, the miserable women felt their way through the dark, stumbling and falling along the road or trail. Along about midnight they arrived at Doc Rutherford's house. Bruised, shivering, ill and shaking from exposure, fatigue, grief, and terror, they could travel no further and were taken in for the night. Morning came, and again they hastened to the improvised prison of their loved ones. There they were viciously taunted with the uselessness of their endeavor to obtain mercy. They were told that if Ellison Hatfield died of his wounds, the prisoners will be filled as full of holes as a sifter bottom. Along about 2 o'clock, Val Hatfield curtly commanded Mrs. McCoy to leave the house and to return no more. She pressed for the reason of this order, and was told that her husband, Randolph, was known to be at that moment attempting to assemble a crowd to rescue his sons. "Of course you know," sneered the heartless wretch. "If we are interfered with in the least, them boys of yours will be the first to die." Mrs. McCoy denied the truth of the report, but her protestations were in vain. The two women saw themselves compelled to abandon the utterly useless struggle to save their loved ones, and departed. It was the last time they saw them alive. All along throughout their confinement, the brothers had shown a brave spirit. Now they lost all hope of rescue, as from hour to hour the band of enemies increased until a small army had assembled. Through the open door they saw them sitting or standing in groups. Some were idly playing cards, others singing ribald songs or church hymns, whichever struck their fancy. All of them were drinking heavily. They heard an animated discussion as to the manner of death they should be made to suffer in the event of Ellison Hatfield's death. Some had suggested hanging. Then one proposed that they make it a shooting match, with live human beings for a target. The idea was adopted by acclamation. Along in the afternoon of the 9th of August, the third day since the wounding of Ellison Hatfield, the assembled band was suddenly startled and every man brought to his feet by the sounds of a galloping horse. Instinctively, they realized they were about to have news of Ellison Hatfield. The stir among their guards had aroused the attention of the prisoners. They easily guessed its portent. It was not necessary to tell them that Ellison Hatfield was dead. His corpse had been brought to the home of Elias Hatfield, who, together with a number of others that had been waiting at the bedside of the dying man, now augmented the Hatfield forces at the old schoolhouse. A mock trial was had, and sentence of death passed upon the three McCoy brothers. These helpless, hopeless creatures, tied to one another like cattle about to be delivered to the slaughterhouse, were now jeered, joked, and mocked. They were not told yet when they must die, nor where. To keep them in uncertainty would only increase their suffering, and that uncertainty lasted to the end. It is 9 o'clock at night. They are taken to the river, placed on a flat boat, and conveyed to the Kentucky side. Within 125 yards of the road, in a kind of sink or depression, the three doomed brothers are tied to pawpaw bushes. Around them stands the throng of bloodthirsty white savages, reared in the midst of a Christian country, and from which every year go missionaries and fortunes in money to foreign lands to make man better and rescue him from savagery. But somehow this region had been overlooked. Not one voice is raised in pity or favor of the victims, an unfortunate man, a youth, and a child. The monsters dance about them in imitation of the Indian. They throw guns suddenly into their faces and howl in derision when the thus threatened prisoner dodges as much as the bonds which hold him will permit. Alex Messer now approaches closely to Famer McCoy and deliberately fires 6 shots into different parts of his body. This is not an act of mercy to end the man's suffering. No, he has taken care to avoid the infliction of any instantly fatal wound. Messer steps back, views the flowing blood and pain-distorted face, and laughs. Ellison Mount, supposedly the most savage of them all, now proves more merciful. He carries a long-barreled, old-fashioned hunting rifle. He throws it to his shoulder, takes careful aim, and blows out the brains of Talbert McCoy, who immediately before the shot fired had thrown his arm to protect the face. The bullet penetrated through the arm into the head. Only the little boy, Randolph McCoy, Jr., is left unharmed as yet. Will they spare him? Some favor his release. One or two demand it. But this idea is hooted down upon the ground that he is as guilty as the others, and even if he were not, now that he knew the assassin of his brothers, it would be utterly folly to leave such a dangerous witness alive to tell the story. "Dead men tell no tales," cries one of the heartless wretches, and impatient of the useless delay, approaches the boy, and with a double charge of buckshot blows off his head. The entire band then fires a farewell volley into the bodies of the dead. We said the entire band. This is not correct, for one of the Hatfields had remained on the other side of the river. "The Bible condemns murder," he had said. But this good man volunteered to stand guard and prevent any interference or interruption of the butchery. The foul deed accomplished, the murderers recrossed the river and entered West Virginia. Then Val Hatfield, the justice of the peace, this officer of the law, with solemn formality administered to the murderers the oath never to betray the name of a member of the band, even should death stare him in the face. What is an oath to such depraved creatures? There, standing on the banks of the river, surrounded by that throng of midnight assassins, in sight of the spot that bore the frightful evidences of the dastardly work, Val Hatfield commanded them to raise their bloody hands to heaven. Each and all solemnly swore to stand by each other, never to reveal the secret of that night's work, asking God to witness their oath. What supreme blasphemy! After their return to West Virginia, parties who saw them and noted they were without the prisoners asked what had become of them. Val Hatfield reported with a smile that they had sent them back to Kentucky to stand the civil law. As soon as the assassination became known, the brothers and relatives of the dead untied the torn and mangled bodies, placed them in a sled, and conveyed them to their home. Have we exaggerated in the telling of this story? Let us see. Years afterwards, some of the assassins were brought to trial. During the hearing of the case against Val Hatfield, the West Virginia Justice of the Peace, Mrs. Sarah McCoy, the mother of the slain brothers, testified, "I am the mother of Famer, Tolbert, and young Randolph McCoy. They are dead. They were killed on the night of August 9, 1882. I saw them on the Monday before that, at Floyd Hatfield's, while they were under arrest. The next time I saw them was over on Mate Creek, in Logan County, West Virginia, at a schoolhouse. When I got there, Val Hatfield was sitting by them with a shotgun across his lap. I was talking, praying, and crying for my boys. While over at the mouth of Mate Creek, I heard Val Hatfield say that if Ellison Hatfield died, he would shoot the boys full of holes. Tolbert was shot twice in the head and three or four times in the body. Famer was shot in the head and 10 or 11 times in the body, maybe more. The top of one side of the little boy's head was shot off. He was down on his knees, hanging to the bushes when they found him. Tolbert had one arm over his face. Tolbert was 31, Famer 19, and Randolph 15 years old. They were hauled home on a sled and buried in one coffin. When Val Hatfield was sitting by them with a double-barreled shotgun in his lap, the boys were lying on something on the floor, tied together with a rope. I fell on my knees and began praying and begging and crying for my children. Someone said there was no use of that, to shut up. Then someone came in and said that my husband was on the way with a large party to rescue his sons. I told them that there was nothing of it. They said for us to leave.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.